Over 100,000 people have smashed that subscribe button, and honestly, it's a dream come true. I wanna thank everybody for joining me on this programming journey. My goal for this channel was to help inspire new and experienced programmers be a better developer. Most of my subscribers have joined through my shorts, which I'm super grateful for. Now I need to focus more on making long form content. So if you have any suggestions on what you'd like to see, make sure you comment below. I made a post a couple days ago saying that I wanted to do a Q&A and received a lot of questions. I'll try and answer as many as I can, but if I didn't answer your question, make sure you ask below and I'll probably answer it there. Anyway, enough about me, let's get to it. Hello, Lewis.
Hi, Anish. I get overwhelmed by all these options that are available when it comes to web development. There's so much to choose from when deciding a tech stack. My question being, is it better to keep exploring newer stuff by building little projects or to try and attain proficiency in some technology in particular?
Great question. I would highly recommend being proficient in one technology. The reason I say this is because no matter how long you are in the web programming space, new JavaScript, CSS, and boilerplate frameworks will come out. When you understand the core of JavaScript, it's easier to jump into different frameworks and apply your experience there. You'll also understand how those frameworks can speed up your process. So I would learn JavaScript first.
Hey, Lewis.
Hey, enemy of the state mojito. First of all, I really enjoy your content. Thank you so much. Thanks for making all the informative and helpful videos. You're so welcome. I'm looking to up my problem solving game. My question specifically is, what are the little things I could do to improve my problem solving skills aside from grinding on leak code? From enemy of the state mojito. Sounds like a good mojito. For me, I really improved my problem solving abilities by breaking big tasks into micro tasks. I would instead break it into 10 smaller pieces and then focus on breaking each problem away. In turn, this makes it a lot easier to solve the little problems than it is that big problem. I also find reading other people's code to be a huge help as well. Sometimes understanding the way other people think changed my way of understanding things. Otherwise, practice is key. What is the best way to learn and master competitive coding? By the way, keep making shorts and videos. They're really informative and helpful. Thanks, Lewis. No, thank you, Gamer Geek, for the question. Sadly, I don't really have much experience with competitive coding. The only thing I have that is somewhat similar is a hackathon, but I don't think that's what you're asking. If it is, I would just highly recommend sleeping and then you reuse as much code as possible. Otherwise, I don't really have any advice. Just keep putting your reps in. What are the best projects to learn advanced Python, other than blog page like you said in one of your videos? Soham Chandane, thank you for the question. If you haven't checked out the video, check out the video in question. It's a great video. A little biased, I know. Once you reach to the level of advanced Python after you read something like Beyond the Basics with Python, I would understand where you want to specialize in. What tech sparks your interest? Then you can decide what avenue you want to go in. If it's data science, learn NumPy and Pandas. If it's web development, learn Flask or Django, etc. Specializing in programming is very important. Are you planning on making more full-length coding tutorials / course videos here on YouTube? This is something that I still don't know if I'm going to do or not, but I'm really interested to hear what you have to say. So if you leave a comment below saying that you want to see more course material, like maybe me teaching you Python or JavaScript, I would really be interested to know that, so let me know in the comments. Sup, Lewis.
Sup, Sypho. How you doing, man?
I want to know what you actually do as in your job. Are you a software dev? I'd assume, but a lot of content creators quit their jobs at big companies and become full-time YouTubers / have their own startups. Love from South Africa. Love from South Africa. And love from Canada to you, Sypho. Thanks for the question. So outside of my content creation journey, I actually own my own software and marketing company that I do with my two best friends. My two friends / business partners and I started an agency where we make marketing, design, and software projects for businesses around Canada. We have about 8 or 9 employees, so things are really busy. I work with a couple of software engineers where we develop applications on servers, the web, mobile, and more. How much JavaScript is enough to start learning React? And when do you think you're ready to apply for jobs as a front-end developer? Thank you for the question, Rave Wolvaria. So how much JavaScript to learn before React is kind of a tough question to ask, but there's really no good answer. My recommendation is to be comfortable with the basics of JavaScript and using JavaScript with HTML. After you've done some JavaScript projects, you could always just try React and see how you do with it. You will never feel ready to apply for jobs as a front-end developer, but I would start applying as soon as you have a couple of example projects on your portfolio. For mobile apps, should I go
native app development or cross-platform app development for jobs. I got a lot of controversy when I made a video saying why you shouldn't build a mobile application, but the point was not to make a mobile application. If you're looking to apply for a job, I would heavily encourage you learn native development. You're more likely to be paid better for knowing the specific language and SDKs. Because it's a singular code base and cross-platform app development, you're more likely to get hired at like a startup that is using that stack to build a mobile app fast. I'm a React dev wanting to shift to full-time mobile app dev. Should I learn React Native, Flutter, or Kotlin? Or maybe simply, is React Native still worth it in 2022? Thanks for the question, Haydar. If you're looking to be a full-time mobile app developer, I would say it might be worth learning Kotlin or Swift, since those languages are used exclusively by Apple and Google. However, if you're still a web developer, you can still easily translate those React skills over to React Native. Hi, Lewis. Congratulations for hitting 100K. Thank you so much, Shiva. I'm a student from India who does not have a background in math. I want to become a full stack web developer, but I'm getting stuck in basic JavaScript math program. What can I do to improve my math? Thank you. No, thank you, Shiva. When it comes to web development, you probably don't have to do much math at all, to be honest. If you're struggling with math, I would highly recommend doing a calculus course over on Khan Academy. It's free there and the instructors are just amazing. It basically teaches you how to do math in a programming concept. Hi, Lewis. Hi, Krishna. I am a fresher from high school and I want to go in the tech side. How do I find out which field I'm passionate about? First, I would analyze what you enjoy hearing or watching. A lot of people really want to become game developers from their love of gaming. So if you love gaming, try game development. What's great with programming is that there's so many different niches within the industry that you can really just pick something up, try it, and if you don't like it, you try something else. The important thing is to try, but don't go baseless into the industry thinking it's just gonna get you a lot of money, because money isn't everything and it will definitely not be fun. There's a lot of talk that everyone can be a programmer nowadays. Does that mean that the days of the super geniuses is over, or are these people still absolutely necessary? This is from Living in This Galaxy. Thanks for the question. So being a super genius is fairly subjective. There are lots of people who possess the natural ability to understand things quick, but being a programmer can mean fixing bugs or solving extremely hard mathematical algorithms. I think every role plays a vital part. Hey, Lewis. Hey, George. How you doing? I know this question might look weird, but is JavaScript slow? And is Node.js bad? Because no matter where I go on YouTube, I can always find someone saying that I should switch to go blazingly fast. Thanks for the question, George. So one, Node.js isn't bad. I like it. And number two, a lot of programmers will usually say something is slow for two reasons. One is that they have a superiority complex and they just want to flex on you. And number two is that they might require the speed of the language as part of their use case. If you want blazingly fast speeds, then JavaScript might not be the answer for you. However, most applications don't require speeds down to the milliseconds. Writing code in Node.js or any other language works as long as it's easy to go back to. Hey, Lewis.
Hey, Tudor.
What do you think of Swift? Do you personally use it? Is it worth pursuing? So I've only dabbled a little bit into Swift, but I would highly recommend it if you're looking to get into app development. Being able to get access to the SDKs released by Apple will be a great way for you to differentiate yourself as an application developer. Usually you have to wait for this in the React Native or the cross-platform app, so I would highly recommend you learn Swift. I just haven't used it a lot. Hello. Hello, Carlos. If you had to choose just one, which trait differentiates a senior dev from a junior one? So there's a lot of different answers to this, but I think the biggest one that I see is how they approach a problem. Although it's fairly vague, senior software engineers often know the correct place to look in their own code to fix an issue. They also just have a really deep understanding of their code environment that they're in. Every single programmer Googles the solution to their problem, but software engineers who are senior level just understand where to go in their code and what to look up to the best of their abilities. Will coding AI like Copilot take developer jobs away? I know you've done a short on this, but I wanted to learn more on this. M. Ahmed. Thanks for the question. I don't think it's gonna take developer jobs away, but I do think it's gonna transition developers into more passive developer roles. So instead of developers writing code and features that they've written a million times, they're now gonna work on security vulnerabilities, bug fixes, maintenance, etc. So yeah, I don't think developers are going anywhere. Is learning multiple programming languages at relatively same time or studying one at a time better? Thanks for the question, Alok. I think it's best to learn one programming language at a time because it's just easier to focus that way. Unless you have some sort of reason to be studying two languages at once, like maybe you are in university or something, I would just stick to one language because it's easier to translate over to another language at a later time when it's more relevant to you. Hey, Lewis, hope you're doing well. Thanks, Mohammed. I hope you're doing well too. I want to ask you is that I have graduated this year and I'm so much interested in coding and programming language. So just want to know, should I go for a bachelor course online or offline or for diploma course and with which programming language should I start? And if I want to learn or have some idea about programming language, what do you think? So this might be different depending on where you are, but having a bachelor degree will just get you more doors open, period. So if you have a huge interest in coding, I would definitely pursue that in post-secondary education. The best programming language I think you should learn as an absolute beginner is Python. I have a whole video on it. You should check it out. I go in detail about a free resource you can use. It's awesome. What is your journey to coding in the first place? Is it by a friend, someone you accidentally stumbled by, etc.? Baker Tyler, more like. Thank you for the question, Baker Tyler. So the first time I ever programmed was using the Lua programming language on Roblox back in 2006. Yes, Roblox is that old. I used Lua to program doors that certain users can enter. I then went to college to learn code and then self-taught myself the rest. What inspired you to do coding in the first place? Thank you for the question, NatBlender. What inspired me to begin programming was just wanting to create things. I've been using a computer my whole life. Like I think I was 7 when I had my first computer. So I always wanted to create things like games, software, etc. Is it necessary to have a college degree in today's world? By Sarin. So no, it's not. There's a lot of people who get jobs as self-taught programmers, but let's be real here. It's going to be way easier if you did have a post-secondary degree of some sort. Going from 0 to 1 is what would be the toughest. Once you get that programming job in though, it's a little easier from there now that you have the experience. What is a best hands-on resources for learning DevOps? By Michael George. So I made a short on this, but one of my favorite resources ever, but specifically in the DevOps space, is 90 Days of DevOps by Michael Cade. Michael goes into detail about his 90-day roadmap learning DevOps. It's open source and so very well documented, I couldn't recommend it enough. YouTube advice for aspiring content creators in tech, from your experience. Thanks for the question, Madeira. Right now, I'm still trying to be a better long-form video creator, but my advice for now is to just keep constantly posting content and not worry about the number. You will have this expectation of yourself to have good numbers because of the amount of effort you put in, but you just won't hit it at first. That's a promise. Keep improving yourself and do it because you enjoy doing it. Make content you love and people will follow. That's what I did at least. What's your Meijers Briggs? From Vanessa. So the last time I did the Meijers-Briggs test was years ago and I was an ENFP, the campaigner, I think it is. How can I join in various developer communities for open source and jobs? From Shabam. There are lots of communities across different social networks. If you look enough, you'll find them. But if you're interested, make sure you join my Discord community where we talk about tech, memes, and learn programming. Are you an AI? Why? Is it obvious? Is software developer job boring? Screen of Mohar. Now, not every day is going to be an incredible day as a software engineer, but that's just what you gotta do. Everyone would be a software engineer otherwise. What I love about software development though is that it allows me to switch up what I do every day to make it fun. Sometimes you just have to do those annoying things, but what else isn't annoying? Everything's annoying these days. And the number one most asked question is how much money I make. Of course, I can't answer this question specifically for obvious reasons, but I'll try my best. Since I own my own software agency and trying to grow that business, I reinvest a lot of my money that I would make back into the business. But I take home about $3,000 Canadian, which is pretty low in for what I do. This is way under average rates for an average software developer, but no pain, no gain. Through social media, there are a couple ways I get paid. One is through YouTube AdSense, which is about $200 a month. TikTok doesn't pay me at all through the Creator Fund since I'm in Canada. The other way I get paid is through sponsored content. I partner with brands that share the same mission as I do and give me creative control to provide value to all of you. I'm selective with the brands that I choose to partner with because I want to still provide value to the audience and still help inspire developers, both new and experienced. Thanks for watching this Q&A. If you have any more questions or if I didn't answer your questions that you asked in the post, feel free to leave them down below and I'll be happy to answer them. Again, thanks so much for 100K subs. I don't even know how to comprehend that number. It literally is insane to me. Thank you so much. What type of content would you like to see on this channel? let me know and I'm happy to make it.